Hachette Audio presents Granite Mountain, the first-hand account of a tragic wildfire, its lone survivor, and the firefighters who made the ultimate sacrifice. Written by Brendan McDonough with Stephen Talty. Read by John Glouchevitch.
To my brothers. Prologue, Granite Mountain. It was about 9:30 a.m. when we tramped into the station, back from a six-mile run in the hills. The desert was starting to cook, and the run had been grueling. We grabbed our water bottles and pulled the gunmetal gray chairs into a semicircle and just sat there, dazed, chugging water, saying nothing at all. This was a time when the crew ragged on each other and tried to get someone going. Working man's theater. The basic horribleness of us all as rookies was a popular subject. Today was my turn. "Donut," Chris said, looking at me, sweat running down his face. "You remember your first week? You ran like old people, fuck. Slowly." Laughter rang off the corrugated roof of the station. I smiled. Hell, it was true. "Looks like a gazelle, runs like Chris Farley, that's me," I shot back. "Never let them know it hurts." Just then, I heard Jesse call out something. "Smoke." That got all our attention. "Smoke? Here in Prescott?" We walked outside. Jesse pointed to Granite Mountain, northwest of us. There it was, on the left-hand shoulder. Light gray, not moving. "Jesus, not now," someone mumbled. We were drained. A six-mile run in the desert heat will wear you out. We started getting ready, putting on our yellow long-sleeve Nomex shirts and our Nomex pants and our handmade leather boots. We were willing the smoke to turn white, which would mean the fire was losing power. But it kept getting darker, bit by bit. It was moving, too, to the east by the looks of it, which meant the fire was getting bigger and stronger, and it was coming toward us. We all knew the names of wildfires that hadn't ended well. The Great Hinckley Fire in Minnesota, where a fire tornado burned so hot, barrels of nails melted, train wheels fused with the steel rails, and 418 people died. Or the 1990 Dude Fire, which turned from a nothing blaze to a 30-foot wall of flame, moving at 60 miles an hour, before it chased down and killed a crew of five inmate firefighters and their guard. The Oakland firestorm, driven by a dry Diablo wind, jumped an eight-lane freeway, burned a house every 11 seconds, and killed 25 people. It came close to burning down Oakland itself. Man Gulch, where a blow-up cost 13 smoke jumpers their lives. In Esperanza, it was five firefighters, dead trying to protect a house. Each one had different causes, different conditions, different terrains. But they all shared one factor: tinderbox dryness in the brush and wood that fueled them. And that sure as hell was true for Prescott, Arizona. It was drought conditions here. We'd been in towns after the inferno had gone through. They were sad, bitter places. Places that had been erased, just like the memories and keepsakes that the fire had claimed. I thought of my 2-year-old daughter at home with her mom. What game was she playing right this minute? Was she gazing out the window, watching the smoke approach? I thought of the pictures of her taped to our fridge. In my 2 years with Granite Mountain, I'd walked past many homes just like mine, but gutted and seared. The people traumatized, searching for scraps of their former lives. You never get back everything you lose in a fire. It's a bad time. It hurts. But as much as I dreaded this moment, I'd been waiting for it too. Now I could show my family what I'd been doing for 2 years, show them I was putting my life on the line to keep them and Prescott safe. One final proof that I wasn't the old Brendan anymore. The radio began heating up. The whole town, cops, structure firemen, forestry, was watching the fire line and waiting to see which way the smoke moved. It was turning darker and creeping eastward ever so slightly. The flames even had a name, the Dosey Fire, after a local landmark. "Let's get ready," Jesse said, And listen up, eat now. If we're working Prescott, we sure as shit won't have time to eat lunch. Peak burning time in the Southwest is from noon to 5 p.m. Temperatures rise, relative humidity drops, winds pick up. Those 5 hours are the ones you live for. We refilled our water canisters, then found our chairs again and sat simmering in the 95-degree heat. We waited and watched the smoke plume. Dark gray now. We couldn't go until we were called in. And the darker the smoke got, the greater the chance that call would come. It went to black against the dome of blue sky. Then it started moving to the northeast, faster. The radio crackled. Crew 7? That was us. We started the buggies, big white Ford F-450 trucks with equipment lockers above our heads that held our packs, bins on the side of the trucks that held all our other gear, and captain's chairs for us to sit on during the drive to the fire line. The drivers revved the engines and tore out of the station's driveway. The adrenaline was just about lifting me out of my seat. "Gonna get some!" I yelled out as we sped off down 6th Street.
"Woohoo!"
Air gusting through the windows, wheels squealing around the corners, headed right at Granite Mountain. It was about 20 minutes to the fire line. The smoke was moving all the time. We swiveled our heads to keep it in sight as the buggy took corners. We were driving down a 2-lane highway now. As we got close, the houses on the other side of the mountain were being evacuated. They sat abandoned, with some of the doors left wide open. Not a soul to be seen. The place was under mandatory evacuation. But that didn't mean everyone was out. We headed toward a checkpoint with a wooden barrier thrown up across the road. It was there to keep non-emergency personnel from getting near the fire. The guys manning the barrier saw us coming and pulled it back, shouting to each other that we were the last car getting through before the road closed. They don't close roads unless the fire is moving fast. From that alone, we realized things were heating up. I knew there were people in cars going the other way on the phone with their insurance companies, watching the fire approach and thinking, "My house is gone." We switched to an old dirt road that would take us toward the fire line. It was rutted and pitched, and the buggy swung left and right as we drove down it. Jesse was on the radio trying to get a grip on where we should be. What's the strategy? Who's supervising? Where do we engage? You need to fight a fire from the heel, set an anchor, outflank it, and put it to rest. But this was Prescott, and everyone wanted in. There were cop cars screaming past, and fire companies, and dudes in white shirts running around yelling into their radios. It was chaos. Jesse was asking people what the plan was, and they were telling him, "We're working on it." The fire was out of control, 0% contained. Everywhere you looked, it was going off. My heart was revving so high my veins ached. Chris slowed the buggy, and as soon as it came to a stop, we jumped out. The guys were amped. You could feel it. It reminded me of those soldiers at Stalingrad. The fire was threatening our homes, our families. It was time to fight. Jesse went off and got the plan of attack before returning to give us a quick briefing. When Jesse left, we grabbed our saws and hucked our packs out of the back as if they were brown bag lunches and strapped them on. Then we hustled out toward the brush. Chainsaws were going off one after the other. 50 pounds felt like 5. And in the distance, we could see the fire sucking in air. The blaze was coming down a slope 3/4 of a mile ahead of us. Jesse called out a basic strategy. "For now," he yelled, "it can cross the highway to the north, but we can't let it cross west of the dirt road. Everyone got it?" Jesse set the anchor, the barrier from which we'd start building the fire line, and pointed out spots for me and Chris to burn. I didn't even have time to put a piece of chaw in my cheek before we were hiking down the highway, looking for a place to go in. Chris and I found a gap in the brush, and he went first. It was half dark in there. The branches scraped along the nylon of my pack as I ducked to get through, pinging on my helmet. I slotted my sunglasses and grabbed my drip torch, pulling a lighter out of my pocket. A drip torch is a gallon-sized metal can used to burn brush and deprive the wildfire of fuel. It drips out a 70-30 mix of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.